your love shine through so all the world can see. You've taken over me. Let me be a reflection of your truth. In turn.
Good morning, Revive. Are you excited to worship the Lord this morning? To welcome our new time guests. If you're new, go ahead and just fill out one of those white cards in front of you. We just love a way to just contact you and thank you for being with us this morning. We also have an amazing book that Pastor wrote today that you get to take home with you. So that's pretty awesome. Also, we have coming up here in October the 18th, pick up your tickets today, the Seventh Time Down concert and other amazing artists. So why don't you go ahead and watch this video with us.
Anyway. say, come to the river.
Tickets and invite a friend. It's an awesome opportunity to introduce them to the church and introduce them to Jesus. Amen. I have a great opportunity for you to give right now. We want to get right back into worship and the word. I know that God has something special for you, but we're going to go ahead and take the offering first. You know, there's a scripture that I love. It says, now thanks be to God, or glory be to God, who can do exceedingly, according to the power in us, can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or all that we think. And I don't know about you, but my thinking affects my asking. The way I think is going to determine how big and how great I ask of God. This is what I'm asking. I'm asking that your whole household will be saved. I'm asking that you and your family will have a transforming experience with the Holy Spirit. I'm asking God for big things about my family and my kids and my life. I'm asking him largely because he told us to, amen? But this is what I'm also asking. I'm asking him to put a great big sign outside on Beltline Road that's shining and flashing, and it's basically a lighthouse that is pointing up to the church, right up this hill here, that says, Jesus saves. Jesus is the answer, and we are so excited because it's just a matter of weeks before that sign is installed, and we are so blessed by your giving. We are just so encouraged and so blessed. We think you are the best givers in the world, and can I say an amount? I'm not sure, but I think we have around 7,000 more to raise to get that sign up, but we're not concerned about it. It's God's will. It's God's plan. It's going to come in. So this is an opportunity for you right now. How many know that when we give to God, blessing just somehow unfolds in our life? It's just a fact. It's just a principle. It happens. Have you experienced that? I'm telling you, it's kind of a weird thing. But if you consistently obey God in your giving, he just pours out his blessings. So that's what we're praying for you this morning. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for every gift that is about to be received today. I thank you, God, that you can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could possibly think or ask, not only in this house and in this community, but God, in families and in marriages and in hearts and in lives. God, there is no limit to what you can do. So I thank you for every obedient giver today. And I thank you for every gift. And I ask, dear God, that you would answer prayer and that you would pour out your blessing in every life. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Watch our announcements this morning.
Victory is yours.
has quaked before. Moved by the sound of his voice, and seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. And it is well. Be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can see. And this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are.
Through it all, That's the key right there. Did you read those words? Did you sing those words? Leave those lines on the screen. Through it all, my eyes are on you. When did Peter begin sinking? When he was walking on the water. When he took his eyes off of Jesus and put his eyes on the waves. Through it all, my eyes are on you, Lord. Not on the circumstance, not on the stuff, not on what I lack, not on what's happened to me. My eyes are on you, Lord. So it is well with my soul. Because you're the God who never leaves us, Lord. You're the God who never forsakes us. You're the God who is always the same yesterday, today, and forever. You will never be anything but good. You will never be anything but faithful. You will never be anything but an ever-present help in my time of trouble. So it is well with my soul. How many believers are in the house today? Come on, how many know what you believe? Make a confession of faith with me today. Make this declaration. Say it with me. I am a believer. I believe in Almighty God the Father, the creator of all there is. I believe in Jesus Christ the Lord, God's only Son, born of a virgin womb. I believe Christ died for me, returned to life, rose to heaven, and is coming back to earth again. I believe in the Holy Spirit and His power to help me be like Christ and do His work. I believe in the Bible, God's holy word, and all His promises to me of abundance and eternal life. I believe in the church, God's forever family. I am the righteousness of God in Christ because I am washed in the blood of the Lamb, filled with His Spirit, happy, holy, forgiven, and free. I am greatly blessed, highly favored, and deeply loved. I am a believer. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated don't be seated yet. You may be seated after you tell somebody, don't miss next Sunday morning. Don't you dare miss next Sunday morning. Okay, you may be seated. And don't look at me like that. You didn't do your sit-ups this morning anyhow, right? So a little exercise is okay. Hallelujah. Don't miss next Sunday morning. Often the Lord gives me or puts on my heart what I'm going to be preaching on for the next few months. We have themes. Sometimes I have a feeling and a direction in my spirit, and God takes me someplace else. Just this week, God deeply impressed on my heart the next Sunday morning service, we're going to be focusing on our families, on household salvation. Listen to this. God says, I will contend with those who are contending with your children. God says, I'm going to fight with those who are fighting with your children. Listen, I don't want to be in God's corner. I want God in my corner. So next Sunday morning, we're going to be praying, preaching, prophesying over household salvation. All five of my children love God, serve God. All five of them are married to people who love and serve God. But I got grandchildren coming in this generation, and I want the fire of the Holy Spirit all over my children and my grandchildren. Don't miss next Sunday morning. Come with me to Israel. Come on. Come with me to Israel, January 30th to February 8th. Only $2,577 from Chicago. Why would a Christian want to go to Israel? Well, let me break it down for you. You want to support the only free people and the only democracy in the Middle East. You want to visit the newly opened United States Embassy in Jerusalem. Hallelujah. We're going to do that. You want a life-changing trip. You will never be the same. The Word of God will come alive to you. And think of this. You'll be showing God that what is important to Him is important to you. His Word, His land, His people, and His promises. And the price goes up in October, so do something right away. Now, if you're watching online, please email pastor@milesholmes.com. Pastor@milesholmes.com. Why? just because. Miles with a Y. Miles with a Y. Pastor at mileshomes.com. And I will send you this information on your screen. I'll send you this information, $2,577 from Chicago. So do join us. We'd love to celebrate the goodness of God in the Holy Land. What do we do every Sunday morning? Say it with me. We are loving the Word and we are learning the Word so that we can live the Word. Pray with me. Father, we surrender our hearts and our minds to you today, Lord. We ask that you would captivate our hearts and our spirits with a deeper revelation and understanding of our place in this world, in this state of Illinois, in this nation of America, on this planet called Earth that you died and bled for, Jesus. Thank you for it. Speak to us today, Lord. May we leave here revived and stirred. In Jesus' name I pray. And everybody said, amen. Monday morning, I was honored and privileged to be asked to represent our church, represent you, and represent the kingdom of God by praying in the capital city of Springfield, Illinois, at the state capitol. And I gathered there with several other pastors and hundreds of prayer warriors from all across the state. And let me tell you, it was a Holy Ghost, Spirit-anointed prayer meeting. From the south, north, east, west points of the state of Illinois, men and women of God came to pray. They asked me to preach and then to pray. I said, I love doing both, so I did. It was such a rich anointing that I decided to bring to you that message and bring to you that anointing so that you can be a part of it right here today. So this is what I shared in our state capitol and the capitol buildings. And I'm not just repeating or parroting, I'm preaching and prophesying this into this house as well. Can you say amen? So in a few moments, I'll ask you to stand and pray with me as we did on Monday morning. I address you today as my fellow Americans and my fellow citizens of this great state of Illinois. And I address you as my fellow ambassadors of the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. His kingdom is so far above any other kingdom or prince or principality that you find in Springfield, Illinois, or Washington, D.C. His kingdom is far above. Can you say amen? His kingdom is within us. And it is also a kingdom yet to come. The greatest manifestation of the kingdom of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will yet come when he returns with all his power and glory as the Lord of Lords. Until then, we as ambassadors are to speak blessing and to be a blessing wherever we find ourselves. We ought to speak a blessing and be a blessing, whether that is in how we vote or how we serve a hot dog at the community barbecue, right? We're to be the blessing of God. We need to speak into our reality and speak into our world. Ushers are helping me distribute a flyer right now. I want every one of you to have this because we have a political race coming up in Illinois. And we have four people. Run, they're right there, please. Distribute to everyone. We have four individuals running for the governor's office in Illinois. And I want to break down with you some of the stands of these people. There is a Republican running for governor. There is a Democrat running for governor. And there is a conservative running for governor. Let's look at some of these moral and social issues. The Republican supports taxpayer funding of abortion. The Democrat supports that. The conservative opposes it. The Republican supports making Illinois a sanctuary state for illegal aliens. The Democrat supports it. The conservative opposes it. Forced speech for abortion referrals. In other words, if you're a pro-life ministry, if you're a pro-life counselor, the Republican and the Democrat support the idea that you should be forced to tell women where they can go get an abortion, even though You're a pro-life counselor. The Republican supports it. The Democrat supports it. The conservative opposes it. Banned speech for professional therapists. In other words, if you're a counselor, someone who gets paid for doing therapy or counseling, and a young person comes to you and says, I feel something in me that I might want to be a homosexual, or I might want to change my gender. Can you help me get over that? And can you help me to stay my own gender? Can you help me to become straight? The Republican wants to ban any therapist from offering conversion therapy or straight therapy. Do you understand? He wants to ban any conservative or any family counselor helping a young person to get unwanted sexual attraction out of their life. The Democrat also supports banned speech. The conservative opposes it. Transgender birth certificates. You don't like what you are today? You want to be a girl instead of a boy? Let's change your birth certificate. Let's change history. Let's change the facts. The Republican supports it. The Democrat supports it. The conservative opposes it. What about defunding Planned Parenthood? The Republican supports it. The Democrat supports it. Opposes it. Back up the truck. Defunding Planned Parenthood. The Republican opposes it. The Democrat opposes it. The conservative supports it. What about recreational marijuana? I'm not talking about medical marijuana. I'm not talking about those who have found it to be a help in a medical source. I'm talking about just getting high so you can drive to the store. The Republican will not comment on it. The Democrat supports it, and the conservative opposes it. Somebody say, we need help in Illinois. Listen carefully to me. Don't leave before you hear the whole speech. Every political issue is also a social and spiritual issue with eternal consequences. I'm going to say that again. Every political issue in front of us is also a social and spiritual issue with eternal consequences. I'm a very patient man. I really am. You ask my wife. Sometimes I'm too patient. I'm a very patient man, but I've lost my patience with other preachers who tell this preacher that American preachers should not talk about politics. I've lost my patience with you. You know what I tell those preachers? I tell them they don't know their God, they don't know their Bible, and they don't know U.S. history. You don't know your Bible about men that were talking to politics, about politics and leadership and social and moral issues to kings and to leadership. What about Moses? What about Daniel? What about Jeremiah? What about Amos? What about all the prophets? What about John the Baptist? You say, yeah, well, he got his head taken off for it. It's time American preachers be more concerned about the truth than their head staying on their body. What about Jesus speaking to Herod? Oh, my goodness. You don't know the Bible. You don't know God. You don't know American history. What about the black-robed regiment? What about it? I don't know what that is. You just proved my point. No. Understand this, however. I am a prayer who preaches, not a preacher who prays. There's a difference. I'm a prayer who preaches and prophesies, not a preacher who prays occasionally. My number one calling is to get alone with God and understand His Word and pray down the glory of God over this church, over this region, over this state, and over this nation. That's my number one priority. In that order, I pray, I preach, and I prophesy. And when I speak to politics, sometimes it's in prayer, sometimes it's in preaching, sometimes it's in prophecy. But people that don't know their American history need to be brought up to speed just a little bit. Anybody ever heard of John Adams? the first vice president of the United States of America, the first president, the second president of the United States of America. By the way, he was there when they wrote the Declaration of Independence. He was there when they wrote the Constitution. He was one of the fathers of this great nation. How many think if you want to know what the founding of America was all about, you could ask John Adams a question, right? He would know. He's not a spectator or a bystander. He was in the middle of it. So let's ask John Adams, Mr. President, what would you say was really the foundational bedrock of the United States of America? And John Adams would say, that's a great question. Let me give you the answer. The general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. These general principles of Christianity are as eternal and as immutable as the existence of God. I've examined all religions, and the result is that the Bible is the best book in the world. Thank you, President John Adams. That's one of the fathers of this nation describing the birth process of this nation. He was in the maternity. He was there when this baby was born. He said, I want to tell you what the conception was like. I want to tell you what the birthing process was about. I want to tell you what the bedrock foundation of this nation is. It's the general principles of Christianity, which are as general and as acceptable as the existence of God himself and his immutable, unchanging characteristics. Let's go a little further in history. 1861, an Illinois boy, Abe Lincoln. Nation was at the crossroads. It was being torn apart. But in 1861, he said these powerful words. Intelligence, patriotism, Christianity, and a firm reliance upon God who has never yet forsaken this favored land, they are still competent to adjust in the best way all our present difficulty. Could he be prophesying to 2018 today? I'm confident, Abraham Lincoln says, that thinking smart, patriotism, loving your country, Christianity, and a firm reliance upon the God who has never yet forsaken this favored land, they're still competent to adjust in the best way all our present difficulty. You know what our Bible says? Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. The state of Illinois and the nation of America stands in the judgment seat and is accused by Almighty God of sin and debauchery and wickedness and failure and rebellion. And you and I today have a mandate upon us. How do we plead as charged before God? You can plead innocent. You can plead guilty. You can plead sickness. You can plead poverty. You can plead depression. You can plead fear. You can plead unforgiveness. You can plead bitterness. You can plead a lack of education. You can plead a bad upbringing. You can plead too much education. You can plead unforgiveness. You can plead anger. You can plead loneliness. Somebody help me preach. Or you can plead the blood. And this morning, this day, this moment in America, this moment in Illinois, God's church must plead the blood, the wonder-working, soul-saving, sin-erasing power of the blood of Jesus Christ he shed on the cross for every sin, for every failure. Ezekiel 36, 33. I know this was to God's people. I know this was to a particular people during a particular time, but if you understand that all of God's word is written for all of God's people at all of God's time, you can claim this like I'm claiming it today. Ezekiel 36, 33, on that day, says the Lord God, I will cleanse you from all your sins, and I will enable you to dwell in the cities, and the ruined places shall be rebuilt. I will enable you to dwell in the cities. Our cities need the gospel. Our cities need God. Val tells me she's going to a ball game. I say, please be careful. Please understand your surroundings. People go to concerts and you know what it's like. We need God in America. We need God in Illinois. So we're going to stand right now and pray. You help me call upon God for his blessing in our city. You raise your voice and help me pray down God's glory. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, standing on your word today, Lord. There is nothing impossible for you. There's no culture so broken. There's no people so lost that you can't sweep with mighty blessing and mighty revival. Oh, God, we need you. God of eternity, God of creation, God of time, God of now, God of right here in this moment, we cry out to you for mercy, Lord. Show mercy on this state. Show mercy on this nation, oh God. The culture of Illinois is broken, Lord. We need truth to expose lies that are permeating our culture. Lord, we allow our kids to pick their gender in the morning depending on what mood they're on, Lord. We've told people that marriage doesn't mean a man and a woman anymore, God. And truth lies fallen in the streets, God. We need your anointing to turn back the tide of evil. We need you to end the violence and the hatred. We need you, oh God, to bring back sobriety and a work ethic, God. Your word says that if a man doesn't eat, he should not. If a man doesn't work, he shouldn't eat, God. Show us, Lord, what made this state great. Hard work, Lord. Labor. Sweat of the brow, God. Forgive us for rewarding everybody and giving everybody a trophy, Lord. When you said, by the sweat of the brow, we're going to live. Teach us, Holy Spirit. God, we pray for the protection of our students and our schools. This spirit of death and violence, Lord, we come against it. We ask for your anointing upon our teachers and staff and security, Lord. We ask for your blessing upon our police officers, Lord. Give them wisdom and intelligence and knowledge above their own human capacity, oh God. Protect them on the streets and highways and byways, Lord, we pray. God, we pray for an end to abortion in Illinois, God. Forgive us. Forgive us, oh God, for allowing our tax dollars to be paid to abortion mills that rip babies out of the mother's womb and sacrifice them in a furnace to the god of Molech. Oh God, forgive us. Thank you for life. Help us to love children and bless them. Forgive us, God, and turn us back to life from conception to natural death, Lord. Help us to love the youngest and the most vulnerable, Lord, and the oldest and the most feeble. May they all be found precious in your sight. Lord, we pray for marriages and families in Illinois. Oh, God, we pray for a revival of righteousness. We come against pornography, immorality, adultery, fornication. We come against all sexual perversion. We come against distraction and busyness, oh, God. And I pray that in the church of the living God, that marriages would be on fire with your presence, that your word would become so strong in our marriages, Lord, that it'll keep us tight and together. Lord, give us marriages that our grandchildren will say, I want to be like grandma and grandpa are. Lord, give us hope for our children and our grandchildren as you stir this nation, Lord. We pray that you'd send revival to Illinois, Lord. From Rockford to Cairo, from Quincy to Danville, Lord. We pray you'd send revival to America, Lord. From Maine to Florida, from Washington State to California, from Alaska to Hawaii to Puerto Rico, Lord. Send a revival of repentance and righteousness and truth and morality, Lord. Send a revival of your word and your precepts. And we say finally, Lord, revive me, Holy Spirit. Revive my heart, oh God. May I fall in love with you, Jesus, more and more, deeper and deeper. And may your kingdom come. May your will be done. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Somebody say, yes, Lord. Somebody say, yes, Lord. Somebody say, send revival, Lord. Send your spirit, Lord. You may be seated. We are so greatly stirred in this state and in this nation of the scourge of addiction that is overtaking our communities. I say with a broken heart, a statistic that if you just hear numbers, it doesn't mean anything to you. But listen to me. Drug addiction is now the number one killer of Americans under the age of 50. Drug addiction. Opioids. Pills. Needles. And we want to say, well, let's give people another gateway drug. Let's make marijuana more acceptable because you want to get a tax dollar, a tax bite out of people's addiction. Ask Colorado how that's working. Almost 2 years ago when the Holy Spirit told me, we've got to fight this head on. We have got a building, we've got a church, we've got ministers, and we need to fight bondages and slavery and addictions in the power of the name of Jesus. So I started Googling and praying and praying, and you know you can Google and pray at the same time. You can search and pray, you can seek and pray. I started looking, and I'd heard about Celebrate Recovery for 25 years because it's the biggest thing out there. I just never had really jumped into it. So I ordered a few books and began to read about it. I was thrilled and stirred and shocked to find out that this program that's in most of the nations of the world now, at least 1 million people have gone through this program. It's in churches all across America. It's a system and a program and a curriculum and a teaching that encourages anybody to know that Jesus Christ has come to set us free from hurts, from bondages, from alcoholism, from sexual abuse, from scarring, from emotional things, from drug addiction. Jesus Christ has come to set us free. The man that wrote that grew up in Collinsville, Illinois. John Baker, the founder of Celebrate Recovery, grew up right here in Collinsville, Illinois. His dad was in the Air Force. This is where he got hooked on alcohol and became an alcoholic, dying until Jesus rescued him. So just a few months ago, we started a Celebrate Recovery program. I announced it. And then Mike Pelagi texted me and said, hey, I'm moving back to Collinsville. I said, you've got to be kidding. But God doesn't kid. God laughs with us, but God doesn't kid. Mike Pelagi and Kim, would you join us on the stage? Take a seat, please. Mike Pelagi is a trained professional counselor for addictions. Kim Moore is called to this ministry. For several months, Kim and Mike and I led the Celebrate Recovery group on Thursday nights here in the church. And then it became obvious to me that I didn't need to be there, that the Holy Spirit was obviously raising these two individuals up to be the leaders of this ministry. Now my heart is in that ministry. I'm praying about it. And I pray that before we leave today, some of you will commit to either coming out on Thursday night, every Thursday night, or getting yourself alone with God and fasting and praying every Thursday night for a couple of hours as these two minister the life-giving power of Jesus Christ to every kind of hurt, habit, and heartache in your life. Can somebody say praise God? Hallelujah. Oh, we need a microphone here. Thank you. Thank you, Valerie. Yeah, make sure they're on. Thank you. That's good. Mike, tell me, you've had a couple of rough weeks since September 7th. What has happened at work the last few weeks?
Well, like Pastor said, I am a drug substance abuse counselor. And we have approximately in Gateway Corrections over in St. Louis, just over 500 men and women that return from their incarceration. Well, as I'm working with them, I develop a pretty good rapport with most of them. And on September 7th, I believe it was, we had a young lady who was murdered on our front porch. It was on the news. And her boyfriend committed suicide, all over drugs. She was our client. Since that day, six more overdoses have occurred as recently as last Thursday, or this past Thursday. So,
Seven deaths
in basically, 14 days? It's not pretty. It's not. I enjoy what I do, but it's very stressful to me. Like I said, one of the gentlemen, his name was Brandon. I had his paperwork all made out. He was going to move on from a sober living home to a new home. Just had everything in line for him. And 2 days later, I get a phone call that he passed away from a drug overdose. It's bad, but I won't stop what I'm doing.
Amen.
People talk about compassion. I talk about passion. I have compassion for a lot of people, but my passion in life is to stop these guys from coming out of prison and thinking there's no hope and they got to go back to the drugs. And
exactly.
It's just you try to get them out of the thinking that they're living a life of broken dreams. You have to show them that there's hope.
And Mike, you have a powerful ministry there because if I went there and said, you can have a new life after you come out of prison, they would look at me and say, yeah, when were you in prison? You were in prison. You're a success story. You're a victory. You're a mentor and a model. Somebody say, there's life. There's victory. There's overcoming. Hallelujah. So, Mike, you can do so much at work, but when you come to celebrate recovery, there's no restrictions. You can tell men and women, Jesus is the answer.
That is the only answer. If you're thinking it's something else, you're sadly mistaken. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It's Jesus and only Jesus that's going to get you through your hurts, habits, and hang-ups. I don't care what they are in your life. And we try to demonstrate that and try to bring that forward and celebrate recovery. My co-leader, Kim, she's just an awesome person to work with. She brings that love of Jesus to everybody at that meeting, no matter what.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what you're struggling with. We try to get you through it and try to get you on that same path, but you have to want it. You have to make the commitment. It's got to be in your head and your heart.
Exactly. Well, Kim, I want to ask you, folks that are in addiction or alcoholism or bondage or struggling with relationships, they already feel beat up, condemned, hopeless, looked down upon. What are they going to find when they come to celebrate recovery on a Thursday night? Are they going to find more condemnation? Somebody point the finger at them?
No, they find a hug. They find compassion.
Say that again.
They find a hug.
A hug.
We greet anyone and everyone who comes into the meeting with a smile, a hug, a handshake. We're so happy that they were brave enough. They were brave. Courageous to come into a meeting that they don't know anyone because they're searching for an answer. And God is the answer. And this program points that every step all the way that we can do nothing without Him, that we are nothing without Him. He created us, and we need to run back to Him for our answers. And so I wanted to just touch a little bit that, when we think about celebrate recovery, automatically we think about drugs, alcohol, you know, prescription drugs, you know, an addiction to that. But there's so many other addictions out there. Yeah. We're addicted to wrong thinking.
Come on.
We're addicted to negative impacts. We allow hurts. We allow disappointments. We allow people who have violated us in one way or another, whether that's physical, emotional, mental. We've allowed that to destroy us, to be destructive. And that in itself, we need deliverance from.
Absolutely.
And so this program to me, I felt called to because of that. I've not had a drug addiction, but I have had other painful things that have kept me from the peace and joy and abundant living. And this program helped even regenerate the very deliverances that God has given me.
Amen. Now, tell me, both of you, either of you can answer. Obviously, we want to invite people to church, right? But is it true that there are some people that church they have a bad taste in their mouth, they've been hurt by church, they can't imagine going to church? Would this be a great first step to getting somebody back into church, maybe coming to Celebrate Recovery first?
Well, definitely, because we are the example of Christ sitting there before them. So if we, the leaders, the co-leaders of this program, are showing them the very love of God just by being in the very same table with them, it is our outlook and our speech. And even they're going to be able to read our actions, our body language. They're going to know the genuality of God's love when Amen. They come to this meeting. And I praise God that, you know, if they're not in a church, we always tell them, welcome home.
Yes, absolutely. So we talked about the fact that it's for addicts, alcoholics, drug addicts, of course. It's for anybody with a life-controlling issue. What about a Christian? They've been in church for 30 years. I've known individuals who've been in church for years, but they still have, you talked about it a bit, those hang-ups or those attitudes or those hurts, those pains that were inflicted on them maybe as a child or as a teenager or young in their marriage, and they need a safe place to talk to somebody. Is Celebrate Recovery a safe place to share those things?
Yes, it is. First of all, it's, the confidentiality is the first thing we talk about. When you're new to the group, we tell you what we talk about in this group stays in this group. Yeah. It doesn't go out of this group. Pastor doesn't know what we even talk about. It's a very confidential issue. If you're in a church and you, I know there's people in churches that don't want to get up and come to Celebrate Recovery or any program and share because they think, well, now when I go on Sunday and sit in that pew,
right?
Guess what? Everybody's going to know what I did or what happened to me. No, doesn't work that way. We keep everything very calm. Nobody's ever going to know. And that's the way you have to have that first step come. Because you won't take that first step if you have that fear in your heart. So we want you to know that anything you would say, anything that you would bring out, anything that you would confess with us stays with us. It doesn't go any further than that.
Powerful.
I'd like to add to that. So I know that we don't talk about it. But I know that those who have already began to come have seen and felt the Holy Spirit
Amen.
Move in these meetings. And I know that they want to talk about it, that they want to share their experiences with God in these Celebrate Recovery meetings. And I know that it isn't my mouth or Mike's mouth that's going to bring in the harvest, to bring in this deliverance and this restoration, it's going to be those who actually experience the very deliverance of God.
Well, absolutely. Somebody give God praise. Now listen, we are excited about this, and I think you know the answer, but how is it that one teaching in a group of people, one teaching can speak to the alcoholic, to the drug addict, to the person recovering from divorce, the person that's struggling with sexual abuse, the person that's struggling with bad attitudes and jealousy and bitterness and unforgiveness? How is it that the same teaching can bless all those individuals at the same time?
Because it's the living word.
That's it. She got it. It's a living word. The word of God applies to every situation. Yeah. That's why you can be in church and everybody gets the same message, the same word. You're eating the same word, but to you it's vitamin C, and to you it's vitamin D, and to you it's magnesium, and to you it's potassium. You see what I'm saying? It's what we need at that moment. Somebody say praise God.
Praise God.
I already mentioned it, but you too can. How can we better support as a church and as ministry folks that love God? How can we better support Mike Pelagi and Kim Moore in your ministry?
Well, we need to get the word out, and so we need your prayers, and we need your service too, you know, as this grows, and we know it's going to grow because God called it to be. We are going to need, you know, people to be recruited to come in and help share the love of God through our actions and through this program, and most definitely, we definitely need your prayers. There's a war. There's a war in this county. There's a war in this state. There's a war right here where we stand. There are people here, even now, that are struggling with something. And, you know, we listen to church and we can get it here. But, man, what an intimate time we have when we can really depict where our hurt is. Where is the root? And God wants to deliver that. He wants to give you full healing.
Absolutely. So we're not saying that preaching and my preaching is not effective. We're not saying that the one-on-one and one-on-five or six or 10 or 20 or 30 people in Celebrate Recovery is better than, but it is different than. And we need both, amen? We need a place where we can come and say, hey, I've had a rough week. I've busted up my marriage. I've busted up my home, my business. Is there somebody I can talk to? Listen closely to me. I've seen this all of my life. I've been around this all of my life, and I cannot think of one alcoholic that I've ever known that intended to become an alcoholic. I can't think of one drug addict. He said, I think I'm going to destroy my family and destroy my life with drugs. I really want to mess everything up. No. No. Broken, hurting people who've lost all hope. Jesus is the hope. Can you say amen? Would you stand with me? I want you to come down, Mike.